Zappa.
Hi. Is it possible that I can get a couple hours from Dublin this afternoon? No, I can't. It can't be night because I have an appointment at 8 o'clock. That's an hour drive away from here. What time is it right now? 4:30. Is it possible that like around 5:30 or so? Okay, that would be great. Yeah, put me on for 5:30.
My first working experience in video was when I did 200 motels. I mean, it took me about 15 seconds to figure out what was going on, and the next thing I knew, I was doing the edits. I don't get scared, but I do get concerned because I don't like violence, and I don't like to see people getting hurt, and I certainly don't want to see any of the guys in the band get hurt. Oftentimes, I'll stop a show if I see something violent happening in the audience, and, well, sometimes fights break out, and you just stop the music and, you know, say, stop it. Don't do that. Because we go out there to entertain people, not to watch them get mangled.
Hanna-Barbera uses the half-hour exposure.
It's down in this dub room, which is on the ground floor, just as you walk in the door at Compact. And somebody said, hey, did you know that you could actually edit in here? And since bump-up time was pretty cheap, I said, hey, why don't I just shoot a television special tonight? So I called up Thomas Nordig, who works for me and is a video fanatic. And he brought his little Hitachi camera over, and we plugged it right in and started interviewing anybody who walked through the door. And we spent 13 hours in the dub room that night.
My name is Craig Letta. I'm a maintenance engineer here, and I just made all of this work.
Well, what did
so
you,
to speak.
I mean, what did you do? I mean,
specifically?
Yeah.
Hooked up two microphones, a camera, which is should not work in this at all, but it does. And what's about it?
It was use continuity of people from the facility, intercut with these tapes that I was bumping up of various musical things. And the original dub room special, it was totally crude. There was no dissolves in it. It was just like punching edits and stuff. And a few days after that, I did an interview with these guys from San Francisco from a show called PM Magazine. And they were asking what I was doing. And I told them about this thing, and they were excited about it. So I said, well, I'll make you a deal. You give me a copy of the footage you're taking of me, and I'll give you parts of the dub room special, and you go edit yours, and I'll go edit mine. So we did. And after I got a hold of their footage, I figured, well, if I spend a little bit more money and take advantage of this continuity, I can make something more interesting out of it, and that's what I did. I went into post-production on it, and the total editing bill was $25,000.
Yes. For those of you who don't know, this is a PZM microphone, which is a really nice device, and it's one of the reasons why we're able to have a stereo dialogue track on this very cheaply produced show. This was hooked up so that Thomas Nordig, the guy who was holding the camera, could actually wear it on his head like this, so he could get very good stereo sound when he was taking these kind of pictures. Now, on a show like this, with these kind of production values, it's so important to have everything looking good and sounding good. That's why we have spared no expense, including $90 an hour, to make this television special, to bring you the real world of compact video. This is the best of the San Fernando Valley.
An unbelievable collection of films now, including stuff from the Garrick Theater, several European documentaries, including one about 200 motels that was shot on the set at the same time as we were doing the film, and some documentaries about the band with Flo and Eddie, and two features that I started but never finished, one of them that was started before 200 motels.
That's Uncle Meat.
That's right.
And the other one is
something that was started as a musical project based on the performance at the Roxy, which turned into the Roxy and Elsewhere album. That whole set of concerts there was all filmed, along with recording sessions at Ike Turner's studio, with the Ikeettes singing background on some of the tunes we were doing, like Cheapness and that kind of stuff. Well, since I'm self-financed, it's kind of on a hobby basis. If I can make enough money out of the Dublin special from touring it around video clubs, then I'll have enough money to reinvest and do another project. Person who will hand carry it from club to club so it doesn't get bootlegged. And since it's very portable, it can go places where you couldn't afford to send a band. It can play in smaller towns and can provide a special kind of entertainment in a lot of places where they wouldn't get a chance to see this sort of thing. And I got to answer the door.
At the Ritz, that the soundtrack on video will always be superior to a film soundtrack. Why is that?
Because the bandwidth of optical track versus the bandwidth of the magnetic track, and also the dynamic range. There's a big difference between the two of them. And optical soundtracks are very dependent on how things are going at the lab today. You know, you send your optical in there to be developed. If it's not developed properly, then there are going to be little focus things or little texture things in there that affect the way the audio is going to come out. It's not that critical for dialogue, but if you're talking about musical material, it's going to suffer a lot, even if you're using Dolby sound. And with the video cassette that we played, that was just coming off the 3/4-inch cassette last night. The sound that you can get on there is as good as a record, better, because there's no surface noise. The dynamic range is just about the same as what you get off of a master audio tape, which is better than a record. And the frequency response on the Dubrum Special is probably 20 cycles up to about 18,000 cycles, as observed on the Ivy audio spectrum analyzer. It's all on there. There's a lot of bottom and a lot of top, a lot of stuff in the middle too. And I don't think you're ever going to get that kind of an effect out of a soundtrack on a film. So I think if you're working in a medium where you're doing musical entertainment, it's probably better to live with the picture degradation that occurs on a big screen and go for the better sound rather than the other way around. I don't know how a person jumps over a fence with two rolls of film under his arm, but this guy did it. Unfortunately, I happened to be sitting in my basement with a broken leg, with a cast sticking out like this, so I was not too mobile to dismiss him, but I looked at the footage, which didn't resemble the stuff that you saw in the Deprim special. It was very gory. His early stuff was extremely bloody, and he was a very weird-looking person. And so after I saw this stuff, I said, well, this is very nice, and what do you want? And he said that he had come to Los Angeles to try and find some work, and that nobody wanted to do anything with him. And I didn't have any visual projects going at that time, so I said I didn't know what to do either, and I thanked him, and he left. And I didn't have an address on him or anything, except that I knew he came from Seattle, Washington. So I guess it was about a year later we started doing the work on that 1974 television show. I said, maybe we should try and get some animation in that. So I got in touch with him, and I brought him to Los Angeles, and he worked for me for a period of 8 years. I shot three frames fast in a row after he'd done one move, and I told him that that would change the pacing a little bit. And that's when he uttered the now famous line.
It's going to change the pacing of it a little bit to do that.
Well, Hanna-Barbera uses the half-hour exposure.
It seems that about 2 weeks ago, Joe Barbera was at my house, and I had the opportunity to show that segment to him, and the response was,
Were you, when you were a kid, were you interested in animation as such?
You bet. When I was about 10 years old, I used to draw pictures all the time, and I even sent a job application to Walt Disney. And I got this letter back on Snow White stationery, which is very technicolor looking, that advised me that if I wanted to be in the animation field, the first thing I should do is go out and see this book called The Art of Walt Disney, which was obviously more expensive than anything I'd ever heard of at that time. You know, the book, it's about like that, big coffee table edition. And I went to the library and found a copy. And in fact, they wouldn't even let me check it out because it was so deluxe. But I looked at it there and had all this geometry stuff in it about how they simulated the pan down a pillar in Fantasia. I don't know whether you've ever seen the book, but I looked at that and realized how little skill I had in geometry and algebra and all that kind of crap, and I said, that's not for me.
Center this coming January, your orchestra music is going to be presented.
I've been trying for a long time to get this music played. And this week, while I was in town for Dubrum Special, we had a meeting with Christopher Keene. He conducts the New York opera. We've been on the verge of recording and performing this music in Poland for several years because my manager's been over there twice and negotiating with the Krakow Orchestra and this orchestra and that orchestra. And we've auditioned several orchestras for the job of recording this stuff because it's a big project. It requires a lot of rehearsal, and which means that an orchestra has to have the time to devote to it, and they have to be available at a price that's within the budget that I've got to spend to make the record. So we had already been to Mexico City prior to coming here. We tried an orchestra there. Last year we tried the Buffalo Orchestra. And so then we had this meeting with Keene, and he said that he felt that either the Long Island Symphony or the Syracuse Orchestra would be capable of doing this project, and they would be interested in doing the project. And so we looked into it, and we booked the date. So at long last, we're going to get a real performance in front of real live people with a real live orchestra of stuff that has been sitting around for years waiting for a performance.
The robots think it's great. I do see what's easy, 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 easy.
Your Halloween show here in New York over the past few years is going to be somewhat of a tradition. Why not this year?
That's easy to answer, because last year when we worked there, we got ripped off by the Stagehands Union, and I refused to go back to the Palladium until the Stagehands Union decides that they're going to do business in an honest way. For years, we were kind of the mainstay of their business there, because we would come in and play like 6 shows, 7 shows, and they would make plenty of money for being stagehands. But last year, when we did this MTV simulcast, the ripoff went like this. They charged $6,000 to MTV for stagehand bills. For what? I don't know.
For one show.
For the Halloween night show. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Then they charge $6,000 to Starfleet Radio for stagehand bills. I don't know. What do? Lift twice as many things? Then they charge me $6,000 because I had my recording truck there. They gave me back $2,000. It's not enough. In the case of what happened at the Palladium, most of the moving of the equipment and stuff was being done by a crew that I brought in that I already had to pay for. Not only did I have to pay their salaries, I had to pay their housing and their food and their transportation, you know, so I've already paid. And it's preposterous to have to do business that way. I mean, when unions keep raising their prices like that in terms of what happens in entertainment industries, like right now, stagehands make more money than classical musicians in New York. And they have benefits that go beyond what a musician will get for playing a concert. A guy can study for 20, 30 years on his instrument to get to be a classical musician, and he makes less money than the guy who gives, cares not and pushes a chair around. Okay? Now, I don't know whether this is because the musicians don't have as strong a union as the guys who push the chair around, but it's not fair. And I think that people should be aware of that, and they should fight it. It's just not fair. Some places in Europe it's much worse, not from the union standpoint, but from the kind of halls you have to work in. And we have definitely seen them all. The place we worked in Rome, there was about 125,000 people at this concert. There was one door. This is an outdoor concert. There was one door for the band and one door for the audience. That was it. You were trapped in there. There were no toilets. There was no running water. For the crew, which is about 25 or 30 guys, to clean up after setting up this equipment in the middle of this place, which was an old slaughterhouse yard. They had like 5-gallon cans of water for them to wash their hands. You know, some one guy would hold the can. It was like going back to the Stone Age. What, this?
Yes.
I invented it.
Of course.
Works like a motherfucker, too. You kidding me? Listen to the fidelity of your voice, the way you just speak into it softly, you know. It's picking you up. It's getting your aura.
Hello in there. Hello.